If you were expecting Beijing, the capital of the People's Republic of China, to be plain and old-fashioned, then you'll certainly get a shock when you get here. The city is in fact a thriving modern metropolis, one of the fastest growing cities in the world, and as such it is quite unrepresentative of most of the rest of China. Of course today it is gearing itself up for staging the 2008 Olympic Games, and so building development is proceeding at a frenetic pace. In Beijing, if you want to get about, you have a good choice. Taxis are metered and inexpensive, but most of the locals who cannot afford a car, and even many who can, resort to cycles. Not long ago, the two-wheeled bicycle ruled Beijing, still evidenced today in the many cycle lanes still operating. Three-wheeled cycle rickshaws are also a fairly good way of transporting goods, but they are becoming more and more of a novelty. Trolley buses offer another good way of getting around the city, though they only operate on the main thoroughfares. As with most tram systems, they offer a clean, cheap and efficient way of getting from A to B. The Beijing Metro is a source of pride to many city dwellers. The two main lines, the Circle and East-West, were built in accordance with Feng Shui, the art of alignment, which is said to bring about good luck. Today, the Metro is expanding rapidly. Already, a new Northern Suburban Line has been completed, and before 2008, the Metro map is likely to be unrecognisable from its current pattern. Tiananmen Square is overlooked by the Gate of Heavenly Peace, a name hardly appropriate to the massacre of thousands of protesting students here in 1991. The gate is a national symbol, restored in the 17th century, but today it is more commonly known as the Chairman's Rostrum. On important occasions, the chairman of the ruling Communist Party addresses the masses from here, and on 1st of October 1949, this is where Mao proclaimed the freedom of the People's Republic of China. Tiananmen Square is the largest public square in the world. On the western side lies the Great Hall of the People. This is the home of the National People's Congress. Today it is also used as a banqueting suite and even as a theatre, as Andrew Lloyd Webber discovered when he staged a special performance of his music here in 2000. Opposite the Great Hall on the eastern side of the square lies the National Museum of History and an adjoining arts college. Right across Tiananmen Square, armed guards are numerous, but they are mainly for view than any real security reason. This one guards the monument to the People's Heroes. The monument is a 36 metre tall obelisk made of solid granite. Illuminated at night, it is essentially a symbol reflecting and respecting all those who have died serving the Republic. B Behind the monument of the people's heroes lies the Mao Zedong Mausoleum. Chairman Mao, the founding father of modern China, died in September 1976, and despite his faults, most Chinese still hold a deep respect for him. Inside the mausoleum, his body can still be seen lying in state. One of the great pastimes for many Beijingers is kite flying, and what better place to do it than here in Tiananmen Square. The weather here in late November is often cold but bright, a perfect time to set your kite skybound, assuming of course that you can get enough breeze. To the north of Beijing lie the tombs of the longest surviving dynasty in Chinese history, the Ming tombs.
You understand that? Uh-huh. So the Great Ming. Ming dynasty in China is the longest dynasty. The power in one family nearly 300 years.
The landscaped path and garden leading up to the tombs are some of the nicest in Beijing province, containing granite sculptures of respected animals, human or otherwise.
So like a rock.
The tombs themselves were only discovered less than 100 years ago, and much work has gone into restoring them for view. The Chinese have much respect for their ancestors, and here paper money piles up behind a wishing stone. In the dark central area lies the ceramic tomb of the last Ming Emperor himself. Nearby there are also boxes containing family treasures and other regalia. The north gate of the tomb is typically Ming in style and overlooks the well-kept gardens below. We continue to travel northwards towards one of the other great attractions in Beijing province. The Great Wall of China, also known to the Chinese as Li Wall, one li representing 500 meters, stretches from the Yellow Sea coast to the Gobi Desert. The wall, some 1,500 miles long but no longer continuous, was built in the Qin dynasty around 210 BC to keep out anyone from the Middle Kingdom regarded as barbarian, and this especially meant the Mongols living to the north. As Genghis Khan supposedly said, the strength of the wall depends on the courage of those who defend it, and although many sentry stations were built, many sentries could be bribed and eventually much of the wall fell into disrepair. Today, sections of the wall have been restored, like this one, and it's still possible to grasp a real sense of history and place here, despite modern attack from day trippers. Below the wall at Bardaling can be spotted some Gobi Desert camels, though they are here mainly to earn their owners some income. The Chinese are well known for their festivals, and even between festivals, any excuse for a celebration is enjoyed by many. These local residents have come together at regular intervals to dance and sing together as a community event. Tonight they are celebrating the passing of the harvest. Chinese restaurants in Beijing are nothing like their Western counterparts. For a start, the meat is carved up for all to see in the front of the restaurant, displacing any chatter of unfresh. This restaurant specialises in Mongolian and Beijing hot pot. In the centre of the table is placed a simmering water vase, around which pieces of meat and vegetable are placed to cook quickly in the boiling water, and then served immediately. The emphasis here is very much on self-service, but the result to the taste buds is quite exquisite. The Benevolence and Longevity Hall greet you as you enter the grounds of the Summer Palace. Guarding everything are the sculptures of fictitious half-animal and half-dragon inventions. The Summer Palace grounds were home to the ruling emperor, his wives and servants, during the months of July and August every year. To the west and covering three quarters of the Summer Palace grounds is Kumminghue Lake. Whether in summer or winter, it is a peaceful place to come to relax or meditate. Along the north shore of the lake is the long corridor, where the emperor would walk before taking high tea. The corridor is 700 meters long and is decorated with many mythical scenes. One of the grandest buildings to be seen in the area is the Sea of Wisdom Temple on the western slopes, a good example of Qing architecture. After his walk along the long corridor, the emperor and his entourage would take high tea here at his floating tea rooms. Of course, the boat is not actually floating at all, being constructed of local solid granite. Off from many of the main streets in Beijing are the narrow alleyways of the Hutong, where a quarter of Beijing's population still lives, tucked away from the gaze of visitors. Despite many of the houses degrading into slums nowadays, many Beijingers still prefer to live in them rather than in the large anonymous high-rise blocks. A good example of Ming architecture, and one of the most impressive temple complexes in Beijing, is the Temple of Heaven. The buildings here are based on the number 9, since odd numbers were considered heavenly, and 9 is the highest of the odd numbers. Two main temples compose the Temple of Heaven. The Imperial Vault of Heaven, seen here, was built in a circular style, but with a square base. It used to contain tablets of the emperor's ancestors, which were used in the winter solstice ceremonies. The main feature of the Temple of Heaven complex is the Hall of Prayer for Good Harvests. This is a magnificent temple mounted on a three-tier marble platform, again with a square base. Amazingly, the wooden pillars inside support the ceiling without nails or cement, which is quite an achievement. As with all Ming temples, the blue and gold of the Buddhist mantra protects the building. Yeah. The Forbidden City is so called because it was off limits for nearly 500 years. It contains the largest complex of ancient imperial buildings in the whole of China. Home to two dynasties, the Ming and Qing, entrance to the Forbidden City 200 years ago would have meant instant death, but today a ticket will do. The buildings seen today have been largely constructed since the 18th century. As with many historic structures around Beijing, they were constantly going up in flames. There have been two major lootings of the Forbidden City, firstly by the Japanese during the First World War, and then by the Kuomintang, who on the eve of the communist takeover in 1949 removed thousands of items to Taiwan. The Forbidden City was one of the major settings for Bertolucci's epic movie The Last Emperor, winner of numerous awards. Today it is definitely a step back in history, and there is quite a serene feel to the place. Maybe the grounds are still inhabited by spirits from the past. This is where Puyi, the last emperor of China, lived, in a modest setting in the northwest corner of the Forbidden City. Here we get a brief glimpse of his throne and living quarters. Beijing is a fascinating mix of the old and modern. As China's sustained capital in a new global world order, where China itself is rapidly expanding, Beijing will remain a great place to visit, and some of its sites, whether it be Tiananmen Square, the Summer Palace, the Temple of Heaven, the Ming Tombs, or the Great Wall, they will stay in your memory for many years to come.